Developing responsive websites can be a major pain point for many designers. Creating individual CSS code for each screen size is not practical. Instead of adding unnecessary breakpoints, utilize media query for specific breakpoints when the layout starts to break. Only in rare cases of unique and complex layout design for a specific device screen, media query may come in handy. In most of the cases, media queries are not needed. In this video, I'll be sharing some tips and tricks regarding responsive web design that I wish I knew earlier. I'll demonstrate how making a simple shift in your approach to writing CSS code can greatly simplify the process. Without further ado, let's start. Hello and namaste everyone. This is Jitsar with Coding Design. Welcome to our channel. If you are new here, please be sure to hit that subscribe button. This video was a special request from one of my subscribers, and I apologize for the delay in posting it. I have been busy with my college exams. However, I'm always open to taking videos requests from my subscribers, so please feel free to leave your suggestions in the comment section below. You can see it's a pretty basic HTML code. Most of the time, most of web designers neglect this meta tag. Within the head tag, you can provide this viewport meta tag. It's not that difficult to understand. What about the user's device width? That will be your web page width. And you can see the value initial scale, which is set to 1. So what does that mean? User can zoom out up to 25% and zoom in up to 500%. So in that case, user may be in different scale. So in order to bring it to the 100%, we will provide their initial scale to 1. And also if you are using any kind of media queries, without this code, you won't be able to apply properly. Within div with class name container, I want to just add some paragraph. Now let's create a standard CSS file and let's give the link for that file. You might have seen like most of the cases for the universal selector, we do provide margin and padding to 0, box size into border box, so that we can prevent all the margin and paddings default value that browser provides. In your browser, you can see there is no any kind of margin and padding, but if you comment out that code, you can see there is 600 pixels of top and bottom margin. So if you don't want to provide any custom margin and padding, then sometimes preventing that margin and padding that may cost you. And by default, if you adjust your screen, you can see this paragraph, it is totally responsive. Now, for the class container, if I give some fixed pixel value for the width, in that case, you can see it's not responsive. And if you comment out that width code, you can see by default, browser provide you responsive behavior. And another way is providing percent as CSS unit, which is the relative value totally based on its parent element. So if I give the 100%, it is totally working fine. So what exactly is going on? As you can see, class container, which is the child of our body tag. So by default body tag, it occupies the 100% width of our screen. So the with class name container, it is occupying 100% width of its parent element. Sometimes providing 100 viewports unit may cost you. So let me show you what am I talking about. When you are providing 100 viewports width, browser, it occupies whole width, including the vertical scroll bar. So because of that, you will be able to see this overflowing content that you may not want. So instead of providing width, it is better to provide max width. Now let's talk about the height. So once again, if you provide this fixed value of height, it is also really costly. Let me show you. If you adjust your screen, you can see now all the text, they are overflowing because we have set our height to fixed value. So if you want to make it responsive, then instead of fixed height, you can give min height. And in your browser, you can see now it's responsive. You can also provide viewport's height. So if I provide there 10 VH, that means I'm giving the 10% of viewport's height. When you're working with icons or any smaller elements, setting off fixed width and height, it is fine. But when you want the responsive design, in that case, it may cost you. Now, if you want to control your all the sizes, spacing, margin, whatever, based on your font size, in that case, you can use rem as CSS unit. As you can see for the border radius, I have given there 0.6 rem. So that 0.6 rem depends upon font size of your root element. In our case, that is the HTML tag. So if you provide different font size for your HTML tag, in that case, your border radius value that may behave differently. So for the HTML tag, if I give the font size of 62.5%, what does that mean? It means that by default, default one rem that is equal to 16 pixels. So when you are providing any different values with rem CSS unit, in that case it is really difficult to analyze like what kind of value you are providing. So I'm converting that one rem is equal to 10 pixels. How does it work? I'm dividing 10 by 16, and if you convert it into 100%, that gives you 62.5%. So now with the help of media query, you don't need to change whole code, just changing font size of your root element. Sometimes that may be enough. Now let's talk about another unit, which is the em. For that, let's create button element. I just want to give the padding. I'm providing all the values with rem unit. So now these values, which is the relative unit, so it is based on the root element's font size. Now for the button element, if I provide em css unit and if I give the font size of different value for that button element, in that case now instead of that root element's font size, em unit's value depends upon the current parent element's font size. Now let's talk about the max function. Now for the width, if I provide that max function, you can provide two values and this function will automatically compare two values, and based on that max value, it will automatically take that value. When that 90% will be less than 600 pixel, at that time it will automatically take that 600 pixel as maximum value. And talking about min function, all the working mechanism that is same. Now instead of that max value, we will take minimum value. Now let's talk about min max function. It is the combination of minimum and the maximum value. So first value that represents minimum value and that second value that represents the maximum value. So based on that value, it will automatically adjust its width. Now let's talk about clamp function. It is the combination of minimum, normal and the maximum width. So within that clamp function, you can provide the minimum value, normal value and the maximum value. So now you can be more creative with that clamp function. Now instead of that for width, you can give for the font size. For the minimum value, I'm giving 3 rem. For the normal value, let's give 1 rem, which is totally depend upon font size of your root element. And if I add with the 2 viewports width, which is totally depend upon the viewports width of your screen. So that will help you to automatically provide responsive font size. And for maximum value, you can give some other unit. So now this one line of code, it is really powerful. Did you see that? You will be able to get the totally responsive font size. And also with the help of that frame unit, whenever you are zooming your page or zoom out your page, based on that, you will be able to automatically adjust your font size. Now as you can see, our text, they are overflowing. So again, I have already told you that instead of giving that width, providing max width is appropriate. And whenever you are giving any height, instead of height, it is better to give minimum height, like if you want responsive design. And also if you want to add like viewport's height for your font size, you can do that as well. Now let's talk about the responsive image. Let's give this image element. And interestingly, by default, browser provide that responsive behavior. So if you provide for the image display to block, and instead of width, if you give maximum width of 100%, then you will be able to get responsive image. But if you provide any specific width and height, in that case you won't be able to get that responsive image. Now let's talk about the aspect ratio. First of all, let's add this video element. For all the image, I just want to give the aspect ratio of 19 by 16, and for our video element, I just want to give 16 by 9 ratio. So for the image, as soon as when I change that maximum width of 20 rem, and for our video, let's give maximum width of 50 rem. Now based on that aspect ratio, it will automatically adjust its height. So in your browser, did you see that? Similarly, instead of numeric value, you can provide other different value for our width. Let's give this 4 different paragraph tag, and based on the class, I'm providing different width for different elements. In your browser, so you can see auto that will occupy the whole width of its parent element, and min content, it will take the maximum length of any word that is from the paragraph. And talking about the maximum content, it will take total number of words that is content within that paragraph, and based on that content it will set its width. And talking about fit content, it is behaving similar as that max content. If I adjust the screen, you will see the difference. So that fit content, it is the combination of min content and max content. Based on your screen size, it will automatically behave as max content and min content. So that fit content value, it can be used for our responsive design. Okay, now let's talk about the CSS Flexbox. For that, let's add some extra HTML code and some CSS code. In your browser, you can see there are 10 different children's. And for the parent element, if I give display to flex, all the elements, they are wrapped within the single line. Now this one is important. If you give flex wrap to wrap, and for your children, so I'm using flex sorting property, that first value that represents the flex growth, second value that represents flex spring, where I have given their one, and for the third value that represents the flex basis, that represents the initial width of that children element, where I have given their 20 rem. So now this whole code, again, it can be reduced. You can remove that boat one. This is also the another shorthand technique. Now there you see that all the widths, they are automatically adjusted based on the screen size, and also you can give some gap. Okay, now you can see it is much more better. Now let's talk about the CSS grid. For that, once again, I'm adding some extra HTML code. So now for the parent element, which is the class cards, if I give the display to grid, and if you give grid template columns, I just want three columns, so you can give same equal fraction unit, or this code can be written in much more simpler form, something like within that repeat you can give three, that represents the number of columns, and that second value, which is the total number of width that it will occupy, which is one fraction unit. But providing manually that number of columns, it won't help us to provide responsive design. Instead, you can give the auto fit. And for the width, I have already talked about that min max function. You can use same function. So for the minimum value, you can give some specific unit, and for our maximum value, we can give one fraction unit. And now for the class card, which is the child element, for that we can give width of 100%. And in your browser, let's give gap. As soon as when you adjust your screens based on that screen size, it will automatically adapt its width and height, and with that two lines of code, you will be able to get that completely responsive design. So whenever you are building your responsive design, taking mobile first approach, that is more appropriate. So what am I talking about? Let me show you. Okay, I have given there two different paragraphs. And for the media query, I'm giving their maximum width, so I'm taking desktop first approach. Now for that class parent, instead of that display to flex, you can change it back to block element. And in your browser, based on that maximum width of 220 pixel, you'll be able to change that display value, and you can see it is completely responsive, but it can be much more simpler if you take the mobile first approach. Let me show you how. So now instead of providing that media query code for maximum width, and also that flexbox code, that is also not important. Now you can see it is not responsive, but now for the media query, you can provide their min width. So now we are taking the mobile first approach. For the class parent, instead of that display block, you can provide that flexbox code. In your browser, you can see you'll be able to achieve the same result with the help of that code. Creating individual CSS code for each screen size is not practical. Instead of adding unnecessary breakpoints, utilize media query for specific breakpoints when the layout starts to break. Only in rare cases of unique and complex layout design for a specific device screen, media query may come in handy. In most of the cases, media queries are not needed. Now let me give you another bonus tips, which is the columns. For that, let me add another paragraph. So this CSS property is rarely used, but sometimes it can be really useful. Let me show you how. For the class container, instead of that display to flex, I can give their columns. And for the columns, I'm again using their shorthand technique. Okay, that first value represents the column count. For that, I have given three. And for the column width, you can give any specific value, or I have already told you that you can use clamp, min max function, or other values. Now you can see there are three number of columns, but if you want to make it responsive, now instead of providing manually that number of columns, you can give value of auto, and that gap, that will help you to provide gap between the columns. So in your browser, did you see that based on number of available width, it will automatically add the number of columns, and also that number of columns depend on columns width value. So if you change that width value, let's look at the browser, did you see that? So yeah, it also helps to make the responsive layout as well. So that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you did learn something, smash that like button. If you have any kind of queries, let me know in the comment box. Share this video if you think someone needs it. And also, if you haven't already ate, hit that subscribe button and also the notification bell icon. Remember, there is always more to learn, so keep learning.